Thank you. Good morning and a very warm welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. This morning we've received apologies from Maurice Golden and from Sarah Boyack. Claire Baker, MSP, is here to substitute for Ms Boyack, although Ms Baker will have to leave to attend for other parliamentary duties during the course of the meeting, but hopefully we'll be able to return later and ask Ms Baker if she has any relevant interest to Claire.
I have an interest to Claire.
Thank you very much. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to take agenda item 3 in private? Thank you. Our second agenda item is our evidence session on our pre-budget scrutiny on the culture spending portfolio. And we have two evidence sessions this morning. Can I first welcome to committee Ian Munro, Chief Executive Creative Scotland, and Councillor Stephen Heddle, Vice President of COSLA, who's joining us remotely from Orkney, and Martin Booth, Executive Director of Finance, Glasgow City Council, who's attending on behalf of the Directors of Finance. So a warm welcome to committee this morning. If I can maybe open question to Mr Munro on Creative Scotland plans for a new multi-year funding programme. We've had very profound evidence from the sector on the importance of multi-year funding as well as the pressures they are under at the moment, and you've outlined a greater number of organisations require funding on a multi-year basis beyond the current network of regularly funded organisations, but we know how pressured this is. So could you let the committee know about your considerations in this regard and your assessment of the impact of funding fewer organisations on a multi-year basis and what impact that might have on the sector?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Thank you for inviting me to give evidence. So on multi-year funding, this is born out of a funding review that we conducted a few years ago now. And we were planning to move forward on addressing the feedback from that funding review when the pandemic hit. And we naturally swung behind delivery of emergency support at that point. But we have now returned to the multi-year and future funding framework arrangements. There are a number of elements to that. I know there's a lot of interest in the multi-year funding, but I do think it's important to recognise that some of the feedback from that funding review that is part of our plans for response are already being enacted. Some of it indeed was accelerated through the period of the pandemic, such as moving much more of our funding offer online and being clear about priorities, our strategic priorities and so on. So that all continues to build, but the multi-year arrangements in particular are of enormous interest, as you've said. Forward planning horizons and the confidence and stability that enables is fundamental to the best quality outcomes in the work that the sectors deliver. However, in this environment, and we provided an update last August, a public update that sets out the broad timelines, so we're continuing to move forward on that basis. I think there is in that update a note that also acknowledges that the forward planning confidence that we need as Creative Scotland around our budgets in particular is quite fundamental to enable the best delivery of that new funding framework. And I think we're keeping it all under review because in the perfect storm that I've set out in the written submission to the committee, which is a combination of rising costs and falling income and a very positive drive forward on policy implementation around Fair Work and Net Zero, for example. That is an irreconcilable equation in the current financial environment, and I think we are very concerned about budgets in year, future year and so on, particularly in the light of the outcome of the resource spending review, which shows a profile provisional at the time and yet to be set. But I think all of the perfect storm of factors at the moment are mean that we are very keen to understand what planning confidence we can get and when we can expect it, particularly the multi-year arrangements and a multi-year budget horizon, to give us the confidence to make sure that we're not doing anything that is going to add to the risks or uncertainties or further destabilisation of the sector when ultimately it is fighting for survival in many quarters, and I'm very concerned about that perfect storm at the moment, and I don't want us to do anything that's going to add to the challenges of that. The fragilities that existed in the sector that predate the pandemic, are back and manifest again, and probably tenfold in certain quarters, I think. The very thin budgets that organisations in particular work on, but also employment within the sector for individual artists and practitioners and so on. There's a terrible squeeze at the moment on those, and I am very concerned about that perfect storm leading to a crisis that appears to be looming large in the current trajectory that we've got. So whilst we're moving forward positively to do our very best with our available resources, we are keeping under review how we enact all elements of that funding framework, and particularly that multi-year arrangement. But it is so fundamental and important for the stability and confidence in the sector and getting the best artistic and creative outcomes.
Thank you. In the submissions to the committee, and thank you all for your submissions. I know Councillor Hedl and Mr. Booth, you've done a joint submission. You've indicated that there are tensions with some of the requests regarding wellbeing and a whole system approach, which isn't actually recognised within the resource spending review. And I just wonder if you could give us a bit more meat in the bones as to what your concerns are there and what you would like to see changed. If I could maybe go to Councillor Hedl first.
Yeah, thanks very much. Again, thanks for the opportunity to give evidence to the committee. I should say that I'm standing in for our community wellbeing spokesperson, Councillor Maureen Chalmers, who's recently been unwell. So I apologise if there's any shortcomings in my evidence. I'm sure we can address that with written follow-up. Regarding the whole systems approach, yes, I mean, we've been very aware that the resource spending review doesn't really paint a optimistic picture for local government. And in regard to the questions just asked, I mean, we've long been advocates of a multi-year settlement, but we need a multi-year settlement that allows us to build back from the pandemic and to be able to adequately support sectors such as culture. And the trajectory, both for revenue and capital in the resource spending review, is not good for local government. I mean, the resource spending review explicitly speaks of priorities towards health and social care and social security, which are obviously undoubtedly important. But the implications for the remaining parts of the local government pie are obviously bleak. And this is why we advocate a whole systems approach. The feeling is that directing the resources towards these sectors, we're tackling the symptoms rather than the causes of the problems. We're not really taking the preventative approach that was put forward 10 years ago in Campbell Christie's submission, and that we need to look at the wider determinants of health and the approach and investment we're going to put towards that. I mean, this is why we advocated an additional priority. So that in the resource spending review, so that they ensure everyone can live well locally. And we still advocate this. I mean, the fundamental answer to your question is yes, we do need the whole system approach to investment in the determinants of health. And that's not just the National Health Service. And it's not just putting a sticking plaster on the problems that's been caused by poverty. It's looking at investing in the services that will be able to prevent these things happening. Support a move back towards increasing life expectancy, address the causes of poverty, including child poverty, and we feel that the importance of culture in our schools is a good way to engage the children in the learning for their own prospects, and also to aid our economy. So in terms of the whole systems approach, it's just adopting the different perspective and having a more place-based and community wellbeing focus that recognises the kind of the wider contribution to all aspects of the public sector.
Okay. Mr. Booth, do you want to come in?
Just to add to the comments that Councillor Heddles made, it's not just on the focus on health and social care and social security within the resource spending review, but also how that flows through into local government budgets. So with the protection that's been provided to social care over the last few years within the budget, and also the additional resources that have been, if not ring-fenced, kind of earmarked towards education costs, the bit that's left, the core services that are left, are coming under ever-increasing pressure. And culture and leisure is one of those major services that's left. So from people's health and wellbeing point, all the pressure in recent years has fallen on, if we simplify it, to bins and libraries. But it's the kind of refuse collection services and environmental services and culture and leisure that have had to bear the brunt of that pressure now for quite a number of years. And that's been really, really challenging to continue to deliver those services. So it's not just at the kind of macro level, it's at a very local level as well. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I want to move to questions from the committee and can I invite Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I'd like to develop the question that the convener asked initially about funding and to ask about the importance of flexibility of funding. Which I think was a message that many of the people who gave evidence to this committee sort of broadcast to us. We did hear quite bleak evidence, as you've already alluded to, Mr. Munro, about the current state of morale and the reality facing our cultural organisations, some of whom have no option but to consider reducing their offer, whatever it might be. The convener mentioned multi-year funding. But other things have been mentioned to us, such as the ability of building up reserves over the years, the spend-to-save approach, etc. As funders, if I can ask you all, as funders, what can you do to facilitate greater flexibility of funding? And if I could start with Mr. Munro.
Thank you. And we did this during the pandemic when it hit as well, but in this current crisis, we have, with existing funding relationships, signalled, particularly for those 121 regularly funded organisations, that we understand those pressures and want to be able to support them to survive. And if that means taking business decisions that see them adjust what they feel they're able to deliver while sustaining themselves with the contribution that we're able to make alongside others, then we'd rather have that conversation rather than stay wedded to the plans that they set out at the beginning of the year that we've contracted against. So that flexibility is there for those that are in receipt of existing funding. Our ongoing funding programmes remain open and are able to see applicants coming in at any point to apply for costs that are relevant at the time at which they apply. So some of those kind of funding pressures are translating, we're finding, into increased demand and levels of requests through those funding programmes. But nonetheless, the decisions that we are then able to take mean that the resource levels are more appropriate to the time at which those applications are approved. But nonetheless, the pressures are still there, and it's quite a volatile environment, isn't it, in terms of inflation, energy costs, audience behaviours and generated from income and so on. Even material supply costs and supply costs in the supply chains, they're all fluctuating. So I think we're doing our very best with the current funding that's available, both commitment already and those that will be applying, to accommodate the context. but there are no financial safety nets there. I think my point that I made earlier about the financial resilience challenges that predated the pandemic coming back again and being even more challenging, there's no financial resilience left, or very few, very low levels of financial resilience left in the sector. We did, in the very final round of emergency support, provide an opportunity to enable organisations to look at how they could uplift their unrestricted reserves into a period of recovery. But and the total of all our emergency support, as per the written submission, has been £151 million through 18,000 additional grants over the 2 years of that pandemic. But even with that last measure, which wasn't just about reactivating activity, but the uplifting opportunity for unrestricted reserves, that's evaporating rapidly. And I think we are in a situation where, with that all gone, no new financial safety nets on the table. People are left with very, very stark, hard choices about curtailing programme, but I fear that those with high fixed costs, such as sort of those that are in buildings, may not even be able to sustain themselves to keep the building wind and watertight, heated, and basic provision in place to enable them to come back at an appropriate moment. So, as I say, the risks are very high in terms of the funding pressures, and we may see some collapse of some of those core organisations. Our own analysis, if I can give you some stark illustrations of this, based on the financial information that we hold at the moment, and we keep this up to date as and when we can. But of the 121 organisations that are regularly funded, even in a standstill funding scenario from us, because of those other pressures, it could be up to a quarter that are insolvent in the next few months. And those beyond that, a risk of insolvency together, those two, could be up to a third of those organisations in the next few months at risk. So it's a very precarious position and concern that we've got about the realities of the situation. We'll do what we can and continue to do what we can within the flexibilities of existing budgets, but our own budgets are under scrutiny and review, and we don't yet have the forward planning figures for next year or the years beyond to be able to translate that for people. So it's a difficult environment for us to be able to translate on as quickly and as best as we can, but we're doing our very best to be flexible.
Thank you for that. Can I turn to Mr. Booth to give perhaps a local government perspective on that?
Yep. Yes. Thank you, Mr. Cameron. It's a very similar position. I'll refer to Glasgow more gently, but I think it equates across all 32 local authorities. Our principal investment into the kind of culture and leisure service is through our own provision through our ALIOs. In Glasgow's position, pre-pandemic, Glasgow Life, which is our culture and leisure trust, had an operating budget of roughly £120 million, of which £40 million was earned income and £80 million was funding from the local authority. The £40 million fell off a cliff virtually overnight. The pace of recovery for that has been slow but steady, is probably a fair way to put it. The council's had to provide additional support, and certainly the COVID resources that were provided by Scottish Government were a significant help with that when that eventually came. But we've got a four-year programme of support to help get Glasgow Life back to where they were. But we couldn't provide them. We didn't have the resources to provide them with £40 million, so we had to meet in the middle and provide that resourcing. And that's ongoing. But we're now in the position, as Ian has alluded to there, where the pressures from inflation on all of these services are really quite significant. Pay inflation, utilities inflation are really, really significant as we go forward. So the resilience to manage through that, even for an organisation of the size of Glasgow Life, is really challenging. But for some of the smaller arts organisations and cultural organisations that are vital to our communities, that pressure is multiplied from that. What the other thing that in Glasgow we've been able to do to help And again, this is pretty marginal, but we have a Glasgow Communities Fund where we've committed a three-year programme, so they get a three-year award. The last batch runs out next March, but again, the council's committed to a three-year programme going forward. That's flat cash, but actually flat cash is a pretty big commitment for local government at this precise point in time when we're dealing with all our own inflationary pressures. But that helps smaller organisations, at least they have sustainability of funding over that three-year period when they're trying to pay wages quite often out of that money. But it is very challenging, and we're not kidding on that we've dealt with all the problems. But it's a little help.
And Councillor Heddle, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, thanks very much. Just providing maybe some of the wider context around flexibilities and reserves. I mean, every day you'll see in the local government information update the start position from individual councils who are spelling out what they need to save in the coming years, and the lack of reserves that they have to do it. And the recent Audit Scotland, Accounts Commission overview of local government presented that very, very clearly and starkly. And in the context of underfunding of local government, and we've made clear, I think, that the local government's seen a real terms reduction of 15% since 2013-14, and that the 7% real terms reduction that's prognosticated for local government in the resource spending review means that there's going to be £743 million less in real terms to spend on services, equating to a reduction of 20,000 local government jobs. Now, I'm saying this quickly, but I don't want to understate how catastrophic this is for local government and the services that we provide. So in this context, flexibilities around policy commitments, it's essential, because the situation where we're in, where two-thirds of our budget is directed spend, means that the remaining third, of which culture is part, inevitably has to be in the front line for any savings that have to be made. And we know this has been happening already, the local government benchmarking framework, and I think the SPICE report that was part of the papers for this meeting shows how even prior to the pandemic, local government had to reduce spending on culture by approximately a quarter. So, you know, the impact is real, and to be able to mitigate that, we need to be able to find flexibilities around the policy commitments and to reduce the ring fencing, to be able to manage our budgets in a way that respects the local democratic priorities set by our electorates. Now, I'm happy to say that we're having discussions around this, not least in respect of being able to fund the local government pay settlement. We need to find £140 million year on year in terms of flexibilities just to pay our staff for this year's settlement. So it's a problem that's going to get worse rather than better. But I mean, the kind of punchline, of course, is that this has a real impact on the what we're trying to address today, and you know, protect culture and the all the benefits that flow from it in terms of sort of well-being, and in terms of providing simply warm places for people to go in terms of the cost crisis. So you know, if we're having to look at reducing our library services, I mean, that's been recently highlighted as a place where people are going simply to keep warm. Clearly, there's impacts that flow from that as well. Thank you.
Sorry. Yep. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I've just got one other rather short question, specific question to Mr. Munro, which is just you will obviously be aware about the Youth Music Initiative and the reports around the funding of that. And I just would like to give you the opportunity to clarify the position there, just for the committee, please.
Thank you. Yes, if I can set this in context, a wider context, I think we know we've got very strong support from the Scottish Government. It translates in terms of the year-on-year budgets that we get, and also the £151 million of emergency support through the pandemic. So we're very grateful to know of that support. There was a wider cross-governmental exercise that started mid-June that recognised the financial pressures as they were emerging at that time and are continuing, to understand where our uncommitted budgets lay. And that was down to technical definitions around contracted spend, as it were, as opposed to sort of moral commitments or processes that were in train. So the Scottish Government has been scrutinising our budgets, like many others across the public sector, to understand what that picture looks like. And we're in the 20th year of the YMI. It's an important year to mark that anniversary. That's an enormously successful programme. And despite it being the 20th year and the cycle of the formula fund having been processed, we hadn't been at that point, at the point of contract, despite that would be the normal process. So at the point these questions are being asked, it was still under review by the Scottish Government. So we, in August, were concerned about that still being the case and wrote to local authorities on the formula fund to make them aware that we weren't able to contract at that point and that there was a hold on the formula fund progressing. It hadn't been picked up by as many people in the local authorities at that point, summer period, of course. And we became aware of this subsequent to that and wrote again, which is what was picked up and reported in the press. And thankfully, yes, the Scottish Government have been able to confirm that funding is secure and it's contracted and progressing and so on. But it's caused problems in terms of the flow of business and the uncertainty for employment, as well as the direct impacts for children and the disruption that has caused. So I'm sorry that's happened, but we were part of a kind of wider governmental exercise that prevented us from being able to proceed in the normal flow of business that we would normally have at that point.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Right, Ms. Speaker. Thank you very much, Convener. Just to follow on the questions about the Youth Music Initiative, was there any other projects or organisations that are funded by Creative Scotland that came under the same issue around non-contracted work being taken forward?
Yeah, I mean, the conversations are ongoing. The full and final budget settlement for us isn't yet determined. So there are ongoing conversations about other elements of uncommitted, uncontracted spend at this point that we're trying to get closure on, to understand whether it is going to be there or not going to be there, to enable us to translate that in the business flow. So it's ongoing, I'm afraid, and unfortunately is becoming harder and harder to manage that position.
So are you at the stage, because you described the Youth Music Initiative, you wrote to local authorities at an early stage to indicate there could be a change in that funding, and any other funding streams that are under the same kind of scrutiny in that situation at the moment, or is it still discussions? Are organisations still expecting to get funding that might not arrive?
Open Access Fund, a second round of an Open Access Fund under YMI that relies on Scottish Government YMI funding that is planned. It's a couple of weeks overdue. We made a round of decisions earlier in the year that the Government have enabled us to commit resource against. But we want to run that second round, but we're not in the position to be able to do that currently because there is still a question mark over that element of the YMI budget.
Another question I wanted to ask, you'd said at the beginning that there was a risk of collapse. I think you'd said the emergency support that was received for COVID was £151 million, and you know, lots of resources were put in by the Scottish Government and the UK Government to try and support the cultural sector through a difficult time. We're now facing cost of living, cost of doing business crisis. The support so far isn't comparable, but would you say the situation is as significant as what we faced with the pandemic for the sector?
I think the risks of this perfect storm are greater than anything that we've seen in the pandemic. I think it's way beyond the challenges of the pandemic, which were deeply challenging enough. I think we've got in that perfect storm a real risk of contraction of the sector. And all that means in terms of employment and audiences and participation and business failure, as well as what it means for tourism and the wider economy. So the kind of ripple effect is quite deep and long. And there may be some decisions that are beyond our ability to respond to with no financial measures in place beyond the current budgets, which, as we've just noted, continue to be under not just pressure but potential reductions themselves, both in year and indeed for future years. So I think the combination of all of that is something that we will do our best to try and navigate, but we're in a position where we don't have the tools that we did have in the pandemic to be able to more meaningfully respond to that. And I think that's very, very concerning, obviously.
And you just finally, you said about buildings being core to this. So would it tend to be the organisations that have been most at risk, are those the ones that have infrastructure and buildings? So it would be like the major theatres and things, or is it across the sector? And I don't know if Ian, if you want to respond, but if Martin, if you, because the local authorities in many cases have theatres and all the venues as well, if what they can, is those the ones that are at greater risk because of rising energy costs and those type of factors?
Yeah, they will tend to be because of the higher levels of fixed costs, but it's not just contained to them. I think there are fragilities across the spectrum of the organisations that we support, both through regular funding but through other funding routes. There are many organisations that are very small in terms of their human resource and capacity that is, under five people. So their ability to manage and navigate that when they're, as I say, fighting for survival is part of the challenge, not just the support that's available to them. So, I think we've got close relationships with and across the sector, people and organisations. But I think those that have got the higher levels of fixed costs, particularly theatres and galleries and so on, are under enormous pressures. Particularly, not just because of inflation, but those energy costs that we've noted, you know, already pre the UK government decision on the price, the energy price guarantee through to March, organisations were sitting at 100, 200, sometimes up to 300% above the norm. If there's nothing beyond March and market forces return, it could see them projecting up to 400, 500, even 600% above. And that absolutely alone is a tipping point in the financial equation for organisations. So for those building-based organisations particularly, that will be one of the sort of defining measures, I think. But it's not just the building, the building-based organisations, but they will be at serious risk because of the nature of their business.
And is there time for Martin Booth to respond to that as well, if you want?
I'll try and do it very briefly. I agree with everything Ian said. I think for the buildings that we're talking about are quite high energy uses. They're big spaces. I think those services that are provided free will come under increased pressure to be open for longer as kind of welcoming places or warm places. But those that are charging because of the pressure on household budgets, so actually being able to afford to go to the theatre or to go to the gym or whatever are going to become ever increasing. So actually the pressure on income budgets as well as the pressure on expenditure budgets is really what's creating, as Ian referred to it, as a perfect storm.
I wonder if I could just ask a supplementary around the Youth Music Initiative and what happened with the announcement and the impact it had. It did expose the very precarious position of a lot of people working in the sector in terms of contracting, and it also disappointingly conflated the Youth Music Initiative with core education funding and curriculum activity, which of course wasn't under any consideration at all from the whole part of it. So I just wondered, it's really for Mr. Booth and for Councillor Heddle, if you've reflected on the impact that had and whether local government is in a position to offer instead of project-based short-term contracting, if you've considered trying to build in a sustainability to the people who are working in that area. I'll come to Mr. Booth first.
Again, I think our funding is under so much pressure that doing any more than we're doing just now is incredibly challenging. Without certainty of funding, to provide more security is really challenging. So, no, it's not something that we've been able to progress with.
Councillor Heddle, do you want to make a comment?
Yeah, I mean, both Martin and Ian are spilling out the direness of the situation and the difficulty in being able to be able to provide extra support. I mean, the problems that we're facing are, you know, it's extremely stark. We've got a £200 million reduction in income from our culture and leisure facilities. Projected increased costs of £100 million. And the situation that was the first question, but we're in 1 year settlements, so it's difficult to kind of plan ahead and provide the certainty that we would like to do. I suppose I'd just like to add that we're discussing these pressures, and it's easy to think of these as kind of revenue pressures, but they're also capital pressures as well as the problems that we're facing in being able to retain our staff or recruit our staff even. We're also facing problems in being able to maintain our buildings or replace our buildings, which is important in the case of energy inefficient buildings when we're trying to move towards net zero. So to describe all this as a perfect storm is just absolutely correct.
Thank you. Could I invite Ms. Minto, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for joining us today, and also for your written evidence. Mr. Munro, if I could ask, first of all, in your evidence, you talked about trying to declutter the landscape for funding, and a group that you've set up or are part of with High and South of Scotland Development and Scottish Enterprise. Can you maybe elaborate a bit on what benefits that's, you know, how you've been progressing with that work?
Sure. It's not a group that we set up, we were part of it, but it is a partnership across the business support network, in effect, recognising that the role of Creative Scotland reaches beyond just the subsidised sector into the commercial, the full sort of commercial market-driven end of the creative economy. And I think what we're endeavouring to do through that group, and it, you know, has been established during the course of the pandemic and is still planning its shared work, is absolutely to try and ensure that the business support opportunities that people are looking for from whatever sector, in our case, the interest in the cultural sector and the creative sector, has an ease of navigation and entry, and that the partners will work together to coordinate that to better effect. So some of this is through a kind of online sort of portal and a kind of triage approach, but it's still emerging in terms of what the models for that are. But I think in this environment, what I would say is that we want to work with, or we need to anyway, work with and through partners to unlock their resources, be they human or indeed financial, in support of the creative businesses and the creative economy more widely, because we don't ourselves have dedicated resource in that regard sufficiently to enable the growth potential that does lie within the creative economy, which is one of those growth sectors that even in these challenging times has proven itself and can continue to do. And I mean, if you take screen alone as one element of the creative economy, it is on a growth trajectory. So we want to be able to find models that continue to sustain it and enable that despite the challenges. So we'll keep the conversations with the partners in the Business Support Partnership Group going, and make sure that we're coordinating and make it as easy as possible for people to access that support.
Thank you.
It's helpful. I was driving past Stirling and I noticed there was a big film base there. So clearly the film industry is busy. I think also last week I attended the cross-party group with India, and it was specifically on trade, but it was also highlighted the importance that culture actually plays when you're beginning trade relationships and also maintaining them. I was interested if any of the work that you're doing with the partnership with the development agencies, if you're feeding in the culture side to the business expansion. And I don't know, maybe Martin, I noticed you were nodding there, if you want to add anything to that as well.
Probably nothing to add to Ian's comments, but again, within Glasgow, we work very closely with our film unit to bring films, and actually I think we filmed a Bollywood film quite recently in Glasgow.
I mean, culture is a strong calling card. Culture is a strong calling card in and of itself, but it is part of a kind of cultural diplomacy strategy that's under development by the Scottish Government, and the kind of soft power elements that are attached to that. So it's a strong economic force for itself, but it is it's a door opener, and particularly the strengths of Scotland's very, very internationally renowned cultural identity. So, it does enable us to open doors, and I think we're keen to explore how that can continue to evolve and develop and increase those opportunities for cultural and creative development, but also what it means in relation to the wider economy, beyond the creative economy itself.
I think Councillor Heddle, you've got your hand up, and I think you're sitting in Orkney, which I think has probably got more brown signs at road ends than the per head of population in the rest of Scotland. So absolutely in the centre of culture.
I'm sitting in Orkney, and I feel like I'm sitting in the bridge of a trawler today, the way that the wind and the rain's kind of lashing against against my house. Very, very briefly on the collaborative work with the business partnership. I mean, I'm a former Cost of the Environment and Economy Spokesperson and Chair of the Business Gateway Board. So, I'm very, very aware of the work of the Business Support Partnership and very supportive of it. I think it's an exemplary example of partnership, and the various partners pooling their strategies and looking at their individual resources to see what can be done. Absolutely, the collaboration is, I think, something that we're rooted in local government through our approaches to community planning and our close relationship with the third sector. And building up these collaborative approaches, as we speak about a whole systems approach, I think is very important. And I think maybe the business support partnerships are a fine example of what can be achieved.
Thank you. I absolutely recognise the collaboration between local authorities and third sector across lots of different areas, but including the health and wellbeing side of things. We heard a bit from Mr. Booth about Glasgow as coming from a smaller local authority. Councillor Heddle, is there anything from a collaborative and learning perspective that smaller councils like Orkney, my own one, Argyll and Bute, can bring to the table in learning about the way that they operate in embedding culture into different areas?
I think undoubtedly we can. I mean, a positive approach to culture is kind of embedded in the local authority. We've always prioritised, for instance, the free instrumental tuition, even before the funding for that came in, and certainly aware of promoting our own cultural activities, to be aware of the plethora of archaeology that's in Orkney, and we support that through things like providing a museum store, which is full of all the artefacts that's gathered from the various archaeological sites, and we're also custodians of the public buildings. We're one of the few councils that has a cathedral, which we look after. But I mean, I think in different ways this is replicated across the whole of local government. I think Martin could rightly point out the £1.4 million in artefacts that's held in the Kelvin Grove collection and others. So, yeah, it's important to be able to make the point that we all contribute to culture in maybe sort of less tangible ways than the funding of services. It's as custodians of culture as well.
And if I may, just one very quick question, Mr. Munro. I think you mentioned in your submission, or it was in the Spice report, about the varying amount of income that comes from the Heritage Lottery Fund or the National Lottery Fund. I was wondering if you have any comment as to, because I think it was at a high in 16-17, over 32 million, and then it's kind of fluctuated a bit. If you have any comment on that as to why that is and the impact that that has.
Yeah, the income from the National Lottery is set through a formula. I shouldn't mention that the National Lottery Act passed in 1993, so next year it will be the 30th anniversary of the National Lottery. And it is there to add value beyond core government spend. But it is reliant on ticket sales and scratch card sales and so on. So its audience buying patterns and behaviours that determine the actual final numbers. Our proportionate share, we're one of 12 distributors across communities, heritage, arts, screen and sports. And we channel National Lottery resource for the arts and screen in Scotland. And we have a planning figure that we set based on an understanding of projections that come from the National Lottery family. And it's only at the end of the year when we close the books we know what the actual numbers are. Now, we're reasonably confident in those planning figures, but there is a degree of fluctuation in them. And there is an interesting phenomenon that can happen in gambling as a whole, which is when people are financially stretched, the income levels sustain themselves because they're gambling more. So there is a fairly reliable income stream there. It's about a third of our overall budget that is the proportion that it represents, with the other two-thirds from the Scottish Government. There are new licence arrangements coming in, and there is a new operator from spring 24, and the transition process for that is underway now. And the intention will be that there's no unnecessary fluctuations that create risks for National Lottery income that we then are able to channel. But we channel 1.78% of the overall total. And as I say, it's fairly reliable and steady. It did drop markedly, like you said, in earlier years, at the point at which we made our last round of regular funding decisions in 2018. The government stepped forward and have year on year since committed to the backfill of the level of that drop at 6.6 million. But it's not written into our budgets for the longer term, so it is still an additional element within the overall financial equation, but it is part of our grant and aid cover that we get. But the level, the planning level for National Lottery at the moment is a fairly stable figure at around 30, 31 million.
Mr. Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks. We've had quite a lot of evidence from cultural organisations about the potential use of the transient visitor levy going forward. I mean, you both, all of you, present quite a stark picture, particularly the potential for up to a quarter of these cultural organisations, many of them anchor institutions in communities, to go under. Can I ask you about what your thoughts are on the transient visitor levy, and is this being built into council planning, council projections for income going forward? Is there appetite across all of Scotland's councils to introduce this, or is it just for the Edinburghs? Can I start with Councillor Heddle on that one, please?
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Russell. It's a good question. The local government's position on the transient attacks, local visitor levy, is that this is an example of discretionary local taxation. That's among the powers that would be useful for local government to have, to rebalance the funding that we face, which is, you know, predominantly from the Scottish Government, very little local taxation that's under our control. And as such, it would be a power that would be in the discretion of the local authorities to use or not use, and then to use as they see fit in terms of the revenues accrued. You're asking specifically whether every local authority wishes to make use of this. I don't know the answer to that question. I would suspect the answer would be no, not every local authority would wish to make use of that. I don't think it would be simply based around the Edinburghs or the large local authorities. I know that my own local authority has an interest in this. We have say 120,000 visitors to our islands, which have a population of 22,000 in terms of people that come for longer stays. We have a greater number in terms of people coming off visiting cruise liners. And undoubtedly this has an impact on our area in terms of maintaining the assets that we have, and you know, effectively stopping them being damaged by the increased footfall. So, from my own local authority's perspective, yeah, we would probably look at directing that towards the support on the tourism industry and support on perhaps our own local industries that might find detriment from mass tourism. But would absolutely be of the opinion that this should be within the discretion of the local authorities to decide how this is applied to match the aspirations of the people who elect us as councillors. So it's something that should be under local democratic control to address local priorities.
Do you think that there should be an expectation that where councils are raising funds in this way, that a proportion of that should go to supporting cultural institutions? Or do you think it should be a pure discretion around how councils use it?
Well, I think there's a two-stage answer to that question. I think that absolutely there will be an expectation. And I think that there's a likelihood that it will be applied in that way. But I think it should be within the discretion of the local authorities to determine this according to their own priorities.
OK, thanks. Martin, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, thanks. Again, just backing up what Councillor Heddle said, I think it will come as additional discretionary spend to support the tourism economy, of which supporting culture and arts is an important element. Particularly in somewhere like Glasgow. There is a working group that's set up between Scottish Government, COSLA and local authorities to take this forward, but it's unlikely to be a significant amount of money for quite a number of authorities. For the big cities and for the more tourist-based local authorities, it could potentially be quite significant sums of money, but for lots of other areas, it's unlikely to have any impact at all. So it doesn't help with the core funding problem, but absolutely it's something that we should be looking to add to help with a very challenging area and to support tourism.
Yeah. Ian, from a Creative Scotland's point of view, I mean, how would you seek to work with this?
I think, I mean, the application of the TVL is a sort of political matter at local government level, and what I would make as a general point that any opportunity to see resources made available by whatever mechanism, in this case TVL, to enhance the resources for cultural activity, we would want to support, as long as it is protected in a way that it ensures that at least some of it is channeled towards cultural support and the added value that it delivers, and not a substitute for or otherwise cut.
I think is another important point that I would make, but we would certainly be supportive if it means that there is more resource available within the overall equation.
Dr. Allen.
Firstly, perhaps for Mr. Munro, you've reflected on some of the budget pressures that undoubtedly exist on the whole public sector, including, it should be said, of course, the Scottish Government, who've seen £1.7 billion disappear out of their budget as a result of inflation. So I don't want to take away from the pressures you've described. I'm just curious to know, do you feel there's anything that can be learned from the experience of the pandemic? Now, you rightly, of course, said that the situation is a very different one and that the pressures are perhaps even greater. But I think we have had some evidence or comment about how during the pandemic, Treaty of Scotland went to some length to try to, for instance, make its application process perhaps more streamlined. I realise we can't make direct comparisons here, but is there anything that can be learned from that experience to bring into the current inflationary emergency?
Yeah, so that is back to one of the earliest points that I made in this evidence session about the funding framework and the multi-year arrangements question that the convener had about the extent to which we will continue to build improvements into our funding offer and the way that we deliver that. That is simpler, clearer, streamlined, more transparent and accountable and proportionate to the level of ask that people have from small grants through to the much larger grants. So that is all being built into and baked into the ways of working for Creative Scotland as we go forward, and particularly the digital component of that, so that people have got their kind of funding opportunity through online resources where it's appropriate, and if there are accessibility needs, and we've got alternatives. So yes, those kinds of operational lessons are part of what we're continuing with, undoubtedly. I think, I do want to, maybe this is the opportunity to make a kind of wider point, if I may, which is allied to this, but we are talking an awful lot about the pressures of the current environment. And I do want to acknowledge again the Scottish Government's support in recognition of the fact that there are wider pressures. There is still budget available, but I think what we're keen to make sure is that we're able to advocate as strongly as possible for direct culture budgets to the greatest level possible, at the same time as working to continue to pursue those cross-portfolio conversations that unlock greater opportunity around, say, health and well-being, education and the environment, for example. So I think it's twin tracks in understanding the money within the system. And there is money within the system. It may not be to the same extent and the greatest degree that we would want. There's always going to be challenges on demand, after all. But if the money is reduced, I think it will inevitably lead to contraction. But the direct culture budgets are conversations that are with the Culture Division. Those cross-portfolio conversations, which everybody is keen to pursue, they are longer. And take time to unlock those kind of wider opportunities. And when we're in this financial environment of pressures, there is a danger on cross-portfolio work that people retreat into their own, into protecting their own areas, whereas actually what we need to do is continue to pursue those avenues for the longer term in terms of the sort of collaboration that will unlock wider opportunities that is to the greater good for everybody, not just in terms of culture, but actually for those other policy areas as well.
Thank you. My other question was about a subject that we've touched on regularly in this committee, and you've alluded to it there, Mr. Munro, but I might address it perhaps to Councillor Heddle and to Mr. Booth, and that is about the wellbeing issue. You've touched, some of you, on warm spaces. Now, I don't pretend that the function of culture as practiced or promoted by local government or by other agencies is simply to provide warm spaces, but I think you've acknowledged that the pressure that will exist on you to provide facilities of that kind. So I just wonder if either of you could say a bit more about how that's going to be worked into what you do.
I think lots of the services already provide that service, and I just think there'll be more demand. So libraries, it's a long time since libraries have been seen just as somewhere to issue books. That's still a core function of them, but they provide a much broader service than that, whether that's So we deliver a Macmillan support service for people suffering with cancer and other long-term conditions, employability support, homework clubs, a whole variety of community engagement activities from within libraries. And it has always been the case that lots of people use a library as their principal social contact. Going back to a comment that Ian made about accessibility and things being available online, then I'm sure reading a book online does have some societal benefits for individuals, but actually going into a library and seeing people, for people that maybe don't have a lot of other contact, is a really important part of lots of people's health and well-being. And maintaining that is going to be really important going forward. I think the demand for that and the ability for libraries and other community facilities to provide that space where people can go and maybe spend a bit more time than they would have done historically because it's a warm place, is going to be a vital part of going forward. Glasgow's not alone. I think most authorities are looking to try to protect their opening hours as much as possible, and maybe providing some additional resources within their libraries over this winter to help people with that. But it's always been a key element of lots of our service delivery.
Can I come in? Can you hear
yes.
me?
Yes. Sorry, I don't know if you can hear us. Yes, please do.
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, I mean, Martin's again, the very good points there. And I suppose just sort of building on that is the, you know, a statement that absolutely local government recognises the value that culture plays in so many of our shared policy objectives with the Scottish Government. I mean, the poverty is clearly one that we're focusing on at present in terms of the cost of living crisis. Child poverty is clearly a thing that sort of plays into our consideration of education and, you know, how to engage children in education coming from the poor backgrounds. And you know, we have great examples of lessons being provided in Dorrit and Aberdeenshire as a way to engage children from all backgrounds in their overall learning. But I mean, there's the kind of the wider issues around addressing climate change, the economic benefits of culture and health and wellbeing that's factored into to all our strategies that we develop at a service level and will undoubtedly play into to our budget setting considerations. Whenever we set a budget this year, I appreciate there's some doubt about that. So the thing that's kind of pervades all this is the idea of the sense of place. And Martin was speaking about libraries not just being places where you get books. You know, they're moved towards being a community hub, an information centre, a place where you can access the internet, a place where you can use a 3D printer. It's this is a kind of place into the wider policy areas of the place principle, which we in local government developed jointly with the Scottish Government, and community wellbeing. And going back to the resource spending review, obviously we regret that these things don't play into it, and we feel that it would be better if it did. And, you know, I appreciate the resource spending review as a starting point, but to bring a sense of place and to bring community wellbeing and to bring the priority that we articulated that everybody can live well locally, I think would be to the benefit of that review and our shared strategic goals. Okay.
Ms.
Munro,
you wanted to
come
in?
Yes, please. Two quick points. One was, I just wanted to clarify the point I made about digital to Dr. Allen's questions earlier. It was about our operational delivery I was referring to, not programmes offered, creative programmes offered digitally, because there was a time and a place during the pandemic where that was prevalent, but it's no substitute for live in-person arts experiences, which people want to return to. So there is a role for digital in terms of the way that people can access cultural programmes and so on, but that's not the point I was necessarily making. On warm spaces, I know from speaking with sector development bodies that we do regularly that they are keen to find mechanisms to coordinate how the sort of physical resources that are particularly building-based resources are warm, welcoming spaces during the winter period. But of course, we've got to be able to get them there. And if you take my point earlier about the cost pressures, may not enable them to be able to open their doors. So, you know, there's a desire there to do the right thing as community resources. But we've got to make sure that we're able to support them as best we can across the spectrum of funding support to enable that to happen. The one I saw a note yesterday, it came across my desk, that I believe Aberdeen is quite advanced in the way that it is coordinating the Warm Spaces Initiative. So it might be something that can be looked at further in terms of how that's being planned.
I think it's, if you have one point of view, I think it's, you know, the having a cultural offering within the warm spaces also is a draw and makes it less stigmatising for people who want to be there. So culture again becomes, you know, whether it's bookbug clubs or dementia choirs or whatever, in these spaces will make a huge difference. So given all the evidence that we have heard, and you'll have seen that, do you think there's a, you know, we're scrutinising next year's budget, do you think we'll see any progress towards its wellbeing being better embedded into to the cross-portfolio work streams, or do you think at this stage the pressures are just too high to see any kind of measurable or identifiable progress in those areas?
I think we must proceed in a determined way to continue to pursue those conversations on opportunities. But as I say, the current environment, let alone better as financial environment, it takes time to enable those conversations to come to fruition and open up those opportunities. But I think it's incumbent on us to continue to pursue that for all the right reasons about the value and benefits, not just culturally, but socially and kind of economically. So I definitely would want us to pursue that. But if I can maybe leave the final answer to this question with something that is worth exploring. And it's about wellbeing economies, and Wales as a country is pursuing a wellbeing economy like Scotland is. And one of the things they did in 2015 was to, through the Welsh Parliament, was to put in place legislation which is about the wellbeing of future generations. And it includes culture written into that act. It means that listed public bodies need to work with people and communities and together to ensure that they have culture as a consideration within the delivery of their services and a greater contribution through culture to the wellbeing economy. So that's not something, you know, if something similar was to happen in Scotland, that's not easy or quick to deliver, but it is definitely for the longer term something that would unlock the true potential of culture's contribution to that wider cross-policy agenda in the wellbeing economy.
Okay, Mr. Booth, and I finally come to Mr. Heddle.
Again, I'll just fully endorse Ian's comments there. We need to do this to go forward, but it is very, very challenging, and survival is probably our highest priority at the moment. But we need to have some hope that we can make things better.
Councillor Heddle?
Yes, delighted by Ian's comment there on the Welsh example. I mean, I think a commitment to our future generations is probably the most important thing we can do. And if we can get to a stage where we're doing that, you know, that will be excellent. In terms of the embedding the wellbeing approach into our policies, absolutely, we're up for it. We reflect this back to the Scottish Government to work with us on this. I mean, our individual local authorities, such as North Ayrshire, have done excellent work on advancing a community wellbeing agenda in Scotland. And the kind of adaptation of the local government benchmarking framework towards a wellbeing economy will be steps in this direction. But I mean, this is a kind of shared endeavour, so you know, we're up for working with our partners and with the national government on this.
I'm looking. I don't think there's any further questions from the committee members this morning. Can I thank you all for your attendance and again for your submissions, which were really helpful. And I'm going to suspend briefly for a couple of minutes to allow witnesses to change over. Thank you. Can I welcome everyone back to a second panel this morning on our pre-budget scrutiny, and a welcome to Committee Angus Robertson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, and Lisa Baird, Deputy Director of Culture and Historic Environments at the Scottish Government. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement?
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to you, and thanks for the opportunity to make some opening remarks. This evidence session for the pre-budget scrutiny is an important part of the normal process for setting annual Scottish budgets, but I think we can all agree that the circumstances facing us today are everything but normal. Our public finances are under huge pressure from soaring inflation, it's at a 40-year high, and from the cost of living crisis. Uncertainty has increased with a negative market reaction to the UK government tax announcements 2 weeks ago. And the combination of the ongoing cost of living crisis, high inflation, and the forecast recession has increased the demand for government funding. Not surprisingly, this has been a consistent theme the committee has heard from witnesses in the culture sector. The limited cash funding the Scottish Government can make available for public services is being eroded by rising inflation. Our budget, as I think you know, for this year is worth around £1.7 billion less than when it was announced in December, with inflation having risen from 4 to 9.9% in the meantime. Our cash plans in the resource spending review announced little more than 4 months ago are similarly being eroded by greater inflation. This is a challenge facing public services in all government portfolios, and I'm acutely conscious, however, of how the economic circumstances are affecting the culture sector in particular. Building-based organisations in particular face steeply rising costs. Everyone who works in the sector is rightly concerned about their pay as living costs rise so steeply. Added to that is the mixed picture of post-COVID recovery in visitor and audience numbers. I hear some positive reports of recovering visitor numbers in museums and galleries and heritage attractions on the one hand. On the other, a more tentative picture for audience figures in performing arts and cinema. Most of all, there is continuing uncertainty as the rising cost of living means that people are undoubtedly cutting back on leisure spending. As the committee has heard from its witnesses, so we are hearing from our own discussions with our culture, public bodies and the broader sector. To address these economic challenges, the Scottish Government is making hard choices to prioritise spending through savings announced by the Deputy First Minister on the 7th of September and the emergency budget review due later this month. While none of this is a surprise to the committee this morning, I think it's worth repeating as a context to what will be a difficult decision in the forthcoming 23-24 budget. The resource spending review envelope for culture and major events next financial year is £172.8 million. That's a cash reduction of £4.2 million, or 2.3%, and that doesn't include the impact of inflation. That's already a challenge before you factor in inflation and indeed the possible further public spending cuts being trailed by UK ministers. I'll continue to argue, as you might imagine, for the most public funding that we can afford for the culture sector. I'm also keen to conclude some work on multi-year funding, even if economic uncertainty means that the later years can be at most only indicative. I know that multi-year figures would help the sector to plan ahead. Convener, I know that the committee wishes to concentrate on the culture budget in its pre-budget discussions, but I'd also be happy to answer any questions on other areas of the portfolio, and if there are any which I cannot answer today, I'll of course write to the committee. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. If I can maybe open Mr. Robertson on what you were saying about the recovery in numbers for museums, because we had an evidence session last week and we heard that while the museums are free to the public, they're making their additional funding through special exhibitions and the discretionary spends in the cafes and in museum shops. So in terms of visitor numbers, how are they capturing whether the discretionary spend of visitors is falling, even though the numbers might be up, if that makes sense in a convoluted way, but if you could maybe reflect on that.
Well, the first thing I would say, I think probably the galleries and museums are in a better position to understand the trends in their in their visitor attendance and spend. I think we know the headline numbers in terms of percentages of who are going. And to be frank, a lot of that's encouraging, isn't it, that people are going. And that is one of the reasons why we are committed as we are to free public access. The hope, obviously, and for those viewing evidence sessions like this, to take every opportunity to encourage people to visit our amazing galleries, museums and public cultural institutions as they can. I mean, I would take a stab on discretionary spending, reflecting how people are feeling about how much money they have in their wallets. And so while they may go and enjoy seeing great works of art, they may be economising on other things. So choosing perhaps to use the cafes less, or you know the amazing high quality shops that there are in our galleries and museums. That would be my best stab at answering that question. But as I say, I think, I have no doubt that the those in charge of galleries and museums will be looking at all of this. But notwithstanding that, I would want to take the opportunity to just encourage people to be aware that these facilities are still free and open to the public to attend. They are warm spaces as well as we enter the winter months, which is a consideration as well. As we emerge from COVID, remind ourselves that we perhaps haven't been to see some of our galleries and museums for a while and take the opportunity to do so.
Yeah. Fine, thank you very much. If I could ask another question around, our focus has been on the wellbeing economy and the ambitions of the government in terms of wellbeing and how that might impact on culture across portfolios. But the evidence from this morning from Creative Scotland and from COSLA would indicate that they feel there's a disconnect between the resource spending review priorities and that aspect of wellbeing. And I just wondered if you'd had time to consider and reflect on that and whether you think, you know, everything's in order for people to be able to make decisions to move towards more wellbeing issues.
Well, I would always want to be very mindful of that and try and ensure that that wasn't the case. Wellbeing matters. And at the same time, I think there's a general recognition that given the very, very difficult budgetary situation that we find ourselves in and the emergency process that the Deputy First Minister is currently going through, and my apologies to the committee because I'm sure you appreciate that we're in a live budgetary process. So there are probably things that you would want to probe and ask and better understand that is a part of the process that unfortunately hasn't been decided and is kind of subject to consideration at the present time. But notwithstanding that, we in culture, and I know my colleagues across government, when making these very difficult decisions, will be trying to make perhaps sometimes impossible decisions, but at all times trying to minimise the impact that it will have on people. But as I've already mentioned, in terms of galleries and museums, for example, we know about the health benefits, the mental health benefits that culture can offer. And if people are still able to access, and they are, these facilities free of charge, then that, I think, is a reflection that this is an important priority for us, and that is a well-being priority as well as a statement of the importance of culture. But the additional point that I was making about being warm spaces is also a reflection of the fact that that's a well-being, has a well-being dimension to it, where, let's be frank, there are literally people who are making decisions about heating or eating. And if there are places that people can go and visit where it's warm, where one can have great enjoyment in appreciating the art and artefacts, the living culture that we see in our museums and galleries and elsewhere, then I think that is in itself a reflection that of the importance of well-being. But I do appreciate that when There is uncertainty about the continuity of funding for different projects that do provide positive support for initiatives that have a well-being dimension. I appreciate that that is a challenge for people who are impacted or fear that it may impact on them. All I can say is that we are taking all of that seriously as we go through the process of the emergency budget. And as you will appreciate, I will be arguing and am arguing as strongly as I can for the maintenance of the maximum possible budget for culture.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Cameron to us?
Thank you and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. This isn't specifically on a budgetary matter, but it did come up in evidence last week, and it's about Historic Environment Scotland and the closure of historic sites to the public. And Alex Patterson of Historic Environment Scotland said that there are currently around 60 historic sites closed or restricted to the public, and I think we'll all have examples of that in the regions or constituencies we represent. And there's also been talk of managed decline, the policy of managed decline. Now, we all understand these sites clearly must be safe for both visitors and staff, but what action is the Scottish Government taking to help HES accelerate the inspection, fixing and reopening of these sites?
So, first, a general point to the observation about the challenge to heritage buildings, in particular in Scotland, and just reflecting back to the committee on the visit that I've been making this week to Paris, where yesterday I was at UNESCO, the United Nations Organization for Education, Scientific Research and Culture. And much of the discussion yesterday that I held was around this issue of the heritage estate. Heritage estate in Scotland, but the heritage estate globally. And the fact that we have a shared challenge in this, because the difficulty that we have in a country that is so full of castles and historic buildings and of great age, and often in an advanced state of decline, without roofs, and built with stone that is eroding and so on and so on and so on. This is a feature that is common across the world because of the changing climatic situation that we find ourselves in. So my first point is the challenge that we face here is not a unique one, observation one. Observation two, unfortunately, is not going to get better in as much as the challenge isn't getting any better. And C, at the third time, as a third observation to this, is that we quite rightly want to uphold the highest health and safety standards when people go and visit, you know, amazing places like, I don't know, Linlithgow Palace or any number of castles which have high walls but don't have roofs and have masonry which is not always secure. So there's just this general point of ongoing challenge. To your specific point about Historic Environment Scotland, well, the first thing I'd like to say is, just as an organisation, I mean, we have a world-class organisation that is trying to deal with all of that. Managed decline, it's not a phrase that I'm comfortable with, but taken at face value, one is trying to manage an estate, and that estate is declining. I mean, it is just a statement of fact that masonry is falling down. These buildings are, and I mean, I would say incidentally, the masonry has been falling down for hundreds of years. It's just because of circumstances now that there is, we have a much higher standards of what is acceptable to let people in to be able to enjoy these facilities. So Historic Environment Scotland is going through the process of trying to ameliorate particular circumstances and particular sites that you've highlighted. And then there's a more general point of the places that are perhaps less well visited as well. And then you have to match that, again, frankly, against the resources that exist, which is a responsibility of Historic Environment Scotland. And we need to do everything that we can to try and ensure that they have the resources to be able to deal with this, because I think everybody appreciates that, that this is about our national heritage. Okay, so far so good, or so far so challenging. There's a little bit of silver lining, I think, which is the recovery of visitor numbers to heritage sites. Again, use the opportunity, because members of the public do watch proceedings of committees like this, to say, to encourage people, please do go and visit our castles, our palaces, our historic sites. But please join Historic Environment Scotland. Get yourself a card. Go along and visit and support our heritage sites. But I would be the first to acknowledge, Mr. Cameron, that when you're talking about finite resources, but you're talking about an ever-growing scale of financial challenge, that one isn't going to be able to manage to do everything. So there isn't a simple fix to this, and I wouldn't want to pretend that there is, but we have to work in partnership as a government, through the agencies that are charged to get on with this. And if it's something that we need to come back to, then I'm fully prepared to do that. But it's not my job to micromanage or to manage at all the arm's length organisations that have responsibility in this area. But no doubt this is something that we are going to come back to and come back to, because the threat remains and it will endure, as will the aspiration to try and protect as much of our built heritage as we can.
Thank you for that. Could I turn to a different issue, which is funding? We had some very interesting evidence from Kirsty Cumming of Community Leisure UK, who called for a move away from what she described as initiative-driven funding. And she said, and I quote her, "There are lots of little pots of money out there, but lots of time and effort are required to put in applications for them. Indeed, they are often for things that are seen as new, despite the fact that there might be programmes that are already delivering something similar across Scotland." I just wondered for your reflections on that, and whether you thought that it was time to end a kind of initiative-led approach and move towards a sort of different system of funding.
To that question, if you don't mind, Donald, we also had evidence from organisations that say that very similar projects from the same artist can be funded from two different pots of those money, and some of the joined up thinking isn't there in some of these ways as well. Thank you.
Yeah, well, I am sure those who are charged with making some of these project funding decisions will be looking very closely at the evidence that has been given, and you've taken evidence from Creative Scotland before I've sat in this chair, and I'm sure that they will be thinking about this, because I know they will be thinking about it. Anyway. I think this is going to be an eternal question, if I'm entirely honest. We want new and innovative projects, don't we? We want to learn the best from elsewhere. We want to try and improve things. So there's always an attraction for all of us, regardless of where we are politically, to say, well, this is a good and a new thing, and we need this new thing to help address this shortcoming or this challenge or this opportunity. And then at the same time, we have a whole series of established projects that are supported, which there may be a feeling that is that they are holies of holies and so can never be challenged. And there's a tension in that, isn't there? And I don't think there's a simple answer to this. But I just think being on the ball with that particular dynamic is what needs to happen. Because we do need innovation, we do need projects, but we also need to protect that which is good and that works. So that's one aspect of the challenge. But the second, about different funding pots, well, again, it was always thus, was it not? And it's not, it doesn't just involve the Scottish Government and Scottish Government agencies that are charged with supporting projects. There are other places that provide funds that go towards cultural projects, whether that is in some cases the UK government. In the past we had the European Union. And beyond that, there are different national and international pots. And there's a dimension to this which also is worthy of consideration, which is how much time are organisations going to spend trying to identify where they can get funding from, then the consideration that one has to be of a certain size to be able to do that efficiently and effectively, and have the expertise to be able to draw down the funds. Again, I think this is, it's an eternal observation. I'm not being critical of it. It is a statement of fact. I think one of the things that I would be concerned about, if it were so, is if people felt that they didn't know where they could turn to draw down funds. And that is as relevant for the public sector, as in government, as it is for other organisations. Because there's some very important funding sources beyond government. Heritage Lottery Fund, the Postcode Lottery, headquartered, incidentally, in Edinburgh, that supports a lot of small, gives a lot of support to a lot of small and medium-sized community and cultural projects. So I think there's a lot in all of that, if the committee has evidence that people are finding it difficult to know where they can turn to, potential criticism one, or two, that they are not being treated fairly when they are seeking to get support, I would like to understand that better. Because I understand that the context in all of this is with constrained budgets, and that won't just be with government, that will be with some of these other funding organisations, both private and public sector. I should also mention philanthropy, because it's also in the context of philanthropy, there are also issues of constrained spending from people who have been extraordinarily generous in supporting culture and the arts. So there is something in all of that, and I do take it upon myself. I do have some responsibility in terms of my convening power, if we want to call it that, to be able to help different areas of funding, whether that's national government, local government, philanthropy, private sector, and I am doing some of that already, and maybe there's more than I can do. I'm open to encouragement, Mr. Cameron.
So thank you for that. And I'm glad you mentioned philanthropy and the private sector, because I think there is as you said, there's a panoply of different funding potential, including some businesses that directly fund cultural organisations. So I think it's not an area that we've really explored much in the last month or so. But thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
I think all members, Alistair, do you have a supplementary or a new question? On this, I'll bring Alistair and then Jenny and then Mark on those.
Sorry, was there something I said that suddenly held a...
I'll resist the temptation, Cabinet Secretary, to talk about a specific building because we've corresponded about it. But on a more general point around the issues you're raising about Historic Environment Scotland, I wonder if you could say something about what the expectation is that you have of the extent to which communities to which historic buildings, which may not be open, are important, are involved and kept aware of what's going on.
So, 100%. Local communities need to know what's happening with local buildings or cultural attractions for a number of reasons. People want to access them. They want to have some understanding of when things might open. But here's another thought, which is there are some places that may want to support the maintenance, the restoration, the reopening of facilities. One might similarly say there may be philanthropists, there may be other funding organisations who have a particular geographical interest or historical connection, or one may have a name which connects one to a place or a building. And we think of people around the world who feel like that. I mean, North America is full of people with Scottish surnames, and they feel a very genuine connection to a place because of their name. And it struck me for a while that I think there's potential in helping join people's connection with a place, with a name, with a building, with a cultural site, as a potential funding stream. And, you know, it's definitely something that I'm keen to explore, because if I meet people from the United States who feel that they come from a particular part of Scotland and they would want to make a contribution to that part of Scotland, it may well be that there's a matching, there's a potential for matching people's interest and support with the challenge that, in this context, we were talking about in relation to Historic Environment Scotland. And I, you know, I'd be very interested in the thoughts of the committee. I'm not fishing for reflections on it right now, but I do definitely think that there is something in us being able to match up community interest in local buildings, historic sites, and so on, but also others who are too. And it might be a way of supplementing the projects that are underway to protect our historic infrastructure. And I think anything that might secure additional funding streams or public support would be a good thing.
Thank you.
Ms. Ruskell, just a supplementary on this question.
Following up on Don Cameron's question, your reflections on that eternal question around short-term funding, or I think it's called projectism. I mean, it is a question that needs an answer, I think, because what I see is a lot of public money being wasted on projects having to eternally reinvent themselves, wasting, you know, core staff time, putting in for funding applications, trying to develop new projects on the back of it, when what they really need is that multi-year, long-term funding to then enable them to get to the place where they may well innovate after that into a different space, but in the meantime, they need a space just to grow into that. So you mentioned power of convening. How do you crack this issue? Because it's been there for years and years and years, and it is grinding the entire voluntary sector down, not just in the culture space, but in many other spaces as well.
So there's
official nodding at that. So,
so if Ms. Baird wants to jump in, she's free to at any stage. But so there's a couple of reflections about this that I would make. One, in terms of multi-year certainty. I mean, I've given evidence to the committee before and said we appreciate in government that having maximum medium and longer term certainty about budgetary projections, whether that is necessarily the happiest news that people get or not, but just having some sense of planning horizon is totally understood. It's absolutely understood. I would hope that people will appreciate that given where the economy currently is, and this is not of our making, that this is making our life more difficult and being able to satisfy that perfectly reasonable demand. But we're still aiming to try and give maximum longer-term understanding of the financial outlook for people's projects or organisations and so on. So point one. So that's point one. Point two, there's another dimension to Mr. Ruskell's observation, which he didn't mention, but which I think is important to also consider in this context, which is there are many projects that are supported for them to start up, for them to grow, for them to find their feet, because they believe that once they are up and they are running, that they will either be self-funding or significantly self-funding. And within that context, there's also a tension, because it's not always the case that they do reach a position where they are as self-funding or totally funded as they initially planned to be. And herein lies a challenge for funding bodies, whether that's Creative Scotland or any other, which is wanting to make sure that one is using funds to help a thousand flowers bloom, but to not always be the ultimate paymaster for everything forever. And, I mean, it takes the wisdom of Solomon to be able to work out how one can get that always right. Because we can, as with our budgetary challenge at the present time, there are those kind of challenges, but others that organisations that are trying to set up and are trying to become as financially successful as they can be, suddenly find themselves buffeted by circumstances. I mean, we don't need to go into COVID as the most recent example of something that very few people saw coming as a challenge of the scale that it was. So I'm just adding another dimension to Mr. Ruskell's point and agreeing with him that the intention is, for very obvious reasons, to try and give people maximum potential understanding of where funding support is and will be over a number of years. But this issue of sustainability of funding as well is... It also has this added dimension that not all projects are supported with a view to being funded forever. It is for them to start up, or they're time limited, or they are doing a particular job. But I mean, I do understand that there are a whole load of organisations out there who are funded regularly and deserve to be funded regularly and are assessed as being good value for money and worthy of support. We need to do that as well as we can in constrained times. And I'm just being absolutely frank with committee. It is not easy. It's not easy for them, and it's not easy for colleagues either in government or agencies like Creative Scotland and others to be able to match the ambition of maintaining public support for cultural institutions. But we're going to have to try and do our best to get through the very bumpy period that we are going into. We're not even in the eye of the storm yet. Is there anything from your side? I think no. Yeah. Okay.
I wonder if I could just ask a final supplementary around this area, Cabinet Secretary. A lot of the sort of third sector voluntary type organisations that we took evidence from were one really thankful for the support that was given through COVID, which helped most of them keep afloat. But also expressed to us how dynamic the funding landscape became at that time.
Yes.
And that all of a sudden, instead of having to feel as if they were jumping through hoops and lots of red tape to achieve a pocket of money, the funders were looking at them as trusted partners and, we know what you do, here's the money, go and do it during this really difficult time. And a lot of them said that that was such a relief to be able to just not have that effort involved in actually getting the money. So it's certainly a significant worry and a significant impact on organisations to have to keep doing that. And while I absolutely recognise it's public money and it has to be accounted for and outcomes have to be achieved, I think they feel now that the sort of red tape barriers have gone back up. And one of the specific things that was mentioned by more than one organisation was they felt, for those who had been, as they saw it, fiscally prudent and had built up reserves, all of a sudden that became something as a barrier to actually access some of the emergency funding. And they felt kind of a little bit hard done to, because they feel as if there's no real guidance from the Scottish Government about, you know, what kind of levels of reserves would be expected from that kind of organisation. I don't know if that is something you can influence, or it should be the Charities Commission or whatever. But it's these kind of inconsistencies and some of the challenges that they faced that I feel, you know, they would want us to raise with you today in our last session.
So I'm very alive to the points that you're making. As I think you all know, the COVID challenge led to an unsurpassed level of dialogue between government, Creative Scotland, and the creative sector. And it was because we were dealing with an existential crisis for the entire sector. And we were in the fortunate position that we had the funds to dispense in that emergency situation, And we tried our best, and Creative Scotland tried its best, to get funding out where it was needed at different phases of the intense COVID period, to deal with the particular aspects of the challenges to the cultural sector, because we were being so well advised as to what they were. And undoubtedly, having the funding in place to then be able to distribute those funds did make it a lot easier than when you don't have the funds. Observation one. Observation two, and I think it's worthy of note, and I think Creative Scotland deserve public recognition for this. When one is dispensing such significant levels of funds, there is always a risk, is there not, that there may be fraudulent applications for financial support. We know that from other areas during the COVID period of PPE and the like. I am not aware of any significant parallel development in terms of cultural funding. And in significant part, that is because of the experience of Creative Scotland as a funding organisation. But we should not take that for granted. So the point that you made, convener, about we're talking about public money here is really, really important. People need to have confidence, and that's whether we're in the cultural sector itself, or whether we're in the public agency that's supporting it, whether we're in government and parliament overseeing it, making strategic decisions around all of that. We should never take that for granted. And I think Creative Scotland deserves to be recognised for having managed that process. Now, on to the substantive point then about cultural organisations now post the most extreme phase of COVID. I completely understand that when there is not the same amount of money going out the door that is helping to support cultural organisations as was during the height of the COVID period, that's a tremendous challenge. People are trying to balance books, people are trying to recover from COVID, people are trying to recover visitor numbers or numbers of people who are paying coming through the door, whether it's a theatre or a cinema or whatever else. In many respects, I hear the warning that things are going to get more difficult. And even looking toward, the comparison between festivals right across Scotland this summer being very successful in comparative terms. The feeling, though, that actually next year is going to be the one that is going to be the more difficult one, not least because of added inflation and all sorts of reasons. But onto the specific point, which I will take away, and I will be happy to write to the committee about, is how are organisations advised in relation to funds that they may hold, and then funding decisions that may or may not be made on the basis of, you have X amount of money in reserve, which means that we will only be prepared to give you Y amount of public funding, when organisations may have made very, very difficult decisions to try and have some reserve funding in place to keep one's head above water when one doesn't know what the situation is going to be like in 3 months or 6 months or 12 months at time. So I'm content to go away and have a look and try and get best guidance on that, because I would want organisations to feel that they are treated fairly. But I think it behoves me to say that we are also looking at dispensing taxpayers' resource during a cost crisis. And so people are having to make decisions on the basis of who has funds, full stop. So all I'm trying to say with that is it's not easy. I want things to be as sympathetic as they can be, but I also want people to be as best advised as they possibly can be. And there's an additional dimension to this, convener, I think, as well. And I've had this conversation with members of the cultural sector who are looking at, you know, next year's festivals or the year after's tour or the whatever it is, where they're having to make medium and longer term financial plans for things, and it is extraordinarily difficult for them to work out how that is going to add up. And we will try and be as helpful as we can. Unfortunately, I don't have the magic wand that is going to be able to answer all of those queries. But I want things to be fair. I want people to be well advised, and I don't want people to feel that they're being penalised for running effective organisations, or they feel that they are being hard done by compared to others. I should say, incidentally, if you have information on circumstances that I and my officials may or may not know about, we do look at the evidence sessions the public evidence sessions and the evidence that you're given very closely. But if there's any information that may not have been in public, or you may have picked up in visits and so on, please do let us know so that we can be as best informed as we can be.
Thank you. I just could just add one further point. Along with the excellent work that Creative Scotland did getting funds out the door, Historic Environment Scotland also distributed about £1.9 million worth of funding for the Historic Environment Recovery Fund, which went to about 40 area-based organisations, some of which were community groups. So that should be recognised too, and I think it answers a part of Mr Allen's question.
Yeah. That's helpful. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Ms Minto, do you?
Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I'll just add to that as well. The List Museums Gallery Scotland did an amazing job in getting funding out. And I think they made a decision that it's looking at organisations to have 3 months of reserves to keep them going. And I think that was very helpful. And local authorities too helped. I want to kind of change the topic slightly. We've just been taking evidence, as you know, from Ian Munro of Creative Scotland, and he talked about the importance of having the culture budget, but he also highlighted importance of cross-part portfolio conversations. And I, for example, attended a cross-party group on India where we were talking about trade, but culture was a really important part of that, which Minister Ivan McKee recognised. Also, we've talked about wellbeing. You were joined, Cabinet Secretary, with the Cabinet Secretary for Health as well last year, I should say. Yeah. And we talked a bit about social prescribing and how perhaps the culture portfolio can help that. And just to say that Ian Munro finished his evidence saying that we must proceed with this in a determined way. So I'm interested to know what the Scottish Government's doing within this area.
Yeah. So thank you. And I think this is probably, I may get this wrong, I think this may be the third or the fourth evidence session where we've touched on this as an emerging, as an ongoing, and hopefully as an initiative which will be making concrete strides. And so I'm glad the issue has been brought up again. So just as a sort of concrete update to the committee, since I've given evidence, I gave evidence together with the Health Secretary, Humza Yousaf. We've set up so this is specifically on health. We've set up a short life working group with health colleagues to agree a clear set of actions for collaboration. So the terms of reference are being drawn up and all the things you would expect to happen to try and have a productive process involving health and wellbeing colleagues for comment. And this includes colleagues with a particular expertise and policy interest regarding social prescribing. But it's going to have a broader remit than just mm-hmm. that, covering a range of policy that crosses over from different bits of government. And we're going to provide more information on the work of this group in our culture strategy action plan, which is being refreshed before the end of the year. So this is in government. I certainly don't want to give the impression that it's sort of gone off to somewhere where it's either A, going to take a very long time to come back, or B, we're not going to hear anything because people are away thinking great thoughts for far too long. It needs to be something that is ongoing. Be assured, we are seized of the matter. I'm not sure the circumstances make it any easier, because it doesn't take very long before people ask questions about additional funding. We're back to our new initiatives, mm-hmm. aren't we? Mm-hmm. So this would be a new initiative. So how do you make a new initiative happen? And at some point, you know, the M money comes into the equation. And then you also have the additional challenge to which I don't have the answer yet, but I'm signalling this, and no doubt you would be asking questions about this if I was here with Humza Yousaf again, which is if there is a growing cultural dimension, as there should be for health and well-being, is that something that health is funding, or is that something that is being funded from the culture portfolio? And these are bridges that we're going to have to cross. I know we have a very strong focus with health. And I think it was very helpful, if I can say so, that both I and Humza Yousaf were sitting next to one another and sort of publicly declaring that we were wanting to make progress in this. I'm very keen that it's wider than that. And I've made the point, I've reported to this committee before, that it was a cabinet decision that culture would be mainstreamed across the whole of government. And I'm very keen, because I can see significant areas of positive impact. I've mentioned before justice, for example, where you can see that culture and different cultural organisations, and many do already play a significant role in helping with rehabilitation and with mental health of people in the justice system. But I think there's much more that can be done. Similar questions then arise about the funding of that. But that shouldn't deter us from making progress with all of that. So I've given concrete answer to Ms. Minto's question in terms of the sort of administrative governmental progress that is being driven cross department. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's the eternal challenge, is it not, in government, I'm sure everywhere, to try and make sure that we're not stuck in our silos, and we are all going to have to work to try and help our colleagues who have a responsibility for health, education, justice and so on, realize that culture and much that the cultural sector can offer should be integral to the thinking of a lot more, mm-hmm. or perhaps more consciously than has been the case up until now. And this was part of the subject of the conversations that I was having with UNESCO in Paris yesterday. And I was very frank about the stage that we are. We have an understanding, we have an aspiration, we are committed to making progress, we are trying to make progress. No doubt some will say we should be doing more or quicker or whatever. Fine, good to have that encouragement. Mm-hmm. A bit of pull and a bit of push is good in this context. I have to say that the UNESCO colleagues were extremely impressed that we are at the stage that we're at, and are very keen for us to engage with them with a view to us being able to share what it is that we are doing here with other countries, with other cultural organisations, not because we have the perfect solutions or we have all of the practical applications of how to make things work, but we are perhaps slightly further down the track than other places are, and that's a good thing. And so this is not just something which I think is relevant, though it is extremely relevant here in Scotland. That's our responsibility. But I think we should do our best to work with colleagues elsewhere, not just to help those who want to emulate, follow, work in parallel with us. But I am very keen to try and better understand where there are countries who might be further down the road. And sorry, I know I'm digressing slightly, convener, but just another sort of point of update. I met last week with the head of the British Council, And it was a subject of conversation for me with him about how is it that we are best informed, and I think this is relevant for parliamentary committees as well as government and ministers, about where are there particular initiatives in other parts of the world which are further ahead, better, doing things in different ways to help us appreciate what we might want to do, might encourage us to do, might help us not take a wrong turn somewhere along the way. I'm not sure we have the mechanism in place for that yet. This was something that was discussed during the Edinburgh Culture Summit about how do we do all of that. And I'm very keen that we do that as well as we can, because it will help us get there quicker than if we're just trying to test our own approach to things without learning from others on all of this. So again, I think the committee will, no doubt, but I'd strongly like to encourage you, please, to work in partnership with ourselves to ensure that we're best informed about where it works. I know there's some committee members who've got very strong, got a very strong interest in this. I see Ms. Boyack isn't in here, but I know that you know, she's another example of somebody together with Mr. Ruskell, who repeatedly, of course, others. Sorry, I've now started mentioning committee members. I'm going to get in big trouble by not mentioning everyone. Let's just keep it. The committee is seized with this. I commend its interest and would want to hear. Mm-hmm. Any suggestions and feedback that they have?
I would just say Cabinet Secretary Claire Baker and I are both involved in the Culture and Communities cross-party group, and Tayside Health Arts Trust spoke a lot about the importance of arts and culture supporting people through illness and chronic conditions. So that's very helpful.
Well, through you, convener, just say, you know, and forgive me, I haven't mentioned this, that there are obviously cross-party groups in Parliament that do a lot of work in parallel to, you know, the formal subject committees of the Parliament. And I would hugely welcome feedback. And unfortunately, mm-hmm. I'm not able to go to as many cross-party groups as I might want to. Mm-hmm. But if one is learning important lessons, meeting important people, that you may feel that we need to be hearing more from or understanding better, please do get in touch, because we're you know, mm-hmm. very keen to be as best informed as we can be.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Earlier this week, I visited Campbelltown Grammar School, and it was interesting seeing some of the importance that school puts on art and music in, you know, throughout their learning. And that tied in with quite a lot of the discussions that were happening in the Culture Summit as well, that the Parliament and Clare hosted some sessions. Specifically, Clare hosted a session on Ukraine. So you've talked about the usefulness of your trip to Paris to UNESCO and hearing what other countries are doing and learning from them and them learning from Scotland. I'm just interested to get your thoughts on how Scotland can support Ukraine from the culture perspective as well.
We didn't talk about this before the evidence session, because I feel like you've been reading my mind on this very point. So those of you at the Culture Summit will know, because I mentioned it when I addressed it, that I think that we have an opportunity to take twinning a lot more seriously. And this was something that I raised with UNESCO yesterday, because it seems to me that they're ideally placed to help drive this together with Ukrainian authorities, who, of course, would have to be at the heart of making such an approach work. For those of you who didn't hear me make the point before, it's a simple one, and it's as follows. We have, after previous conflagrations, so after the Second World War, decided that, for a number of reasons, twinning arrangements are a very useful way of being able to help rebuild, come together, and emerge from conflict. If you look at the twinning arrangements in Scotland, largely with French and German towns and cities, that purpose was very clear. Yes, there was an exchange of people, and especially between France and Germany was very important after both the First and Second World War. But I think there's an added dimension to this. UNESCO told me yesterday that there are, I think I'm right in saying, 198 cultural sites of particular cultural importance in Ukraine, which have already been totally or significantly destroyed. UNESCO is using satellite imagery, and they are logging the damage to cultural sites in real time. This is something new for them. They have not done this in the past. They weren't able to do so in Syria, for example, and they weren't able to do the preparatory work, but they are now involved, for example, in the rebuilding in parts of Mosul. UNESCO is very keen to do a lot of the preparatory work during this conflict, so that when it ends, and pray God it ends as soon as possible, with a victory for Ukraine, the restoration of peace and of justice, but that cultural organisations like UNESCO will be able to work in partnership with the likes of the Ukrainian Culture Ministry to know exactly where one should intervene to help to rebuild. There have already been very high-profile commitments to rebuild the theatre in Mariupol, for example. But there are countless hamlets, villages, towns for whom their church or synagogue has been destroyed, or other sites of particular importance. So to my point about twinning, it's great that we have cities like Edinburgh, which is twinned with Kiev. It's great that cities like Glasgow have been looking at twinning arrangements themselves with Ukraine. But would it not be all the more effective if small towns, villages, towns, as well as cities, would twin with communities in Ukraine? And from here, yes, but internationally too. And that was my point with UNESCO, that they're in an ideal position. Their membership organizes a United Nations organization, so they have national delegations, that if they could push that down through their organization to encourage multiple twinning arrangements to particular small villages and towns that have, you know, lost their hospital, lost their library, lost public services, as a way of rebuilding those communities and their cultural sites as a priority as we emerge from conflict, as soon as that may come, I think that is the best way forward that I can. There may well be other ways of doing it, but it just strikes me as a particularly attractive solution. I've raised it at the Culture Summit. I've raised it in the European Parliament with colleagues in different political groups to try and get them to adopt it and push it down through through the system. I was speaking about it with the British ambassador to UNESCO to encourage through her the Department of Culture, Media and Sport in England to think about this as well. And if there's any best practice that we can establish in that respect here, let's do it. Because I know, having spoken to the Ukrainian Consul General in Edinburgh about this, the Ukrainians are extremely keen on the idea. So, you know, why don't we have a look at seeing what we can do and encourage others to do likewise?
We'd imagine Historic Environment Scotland as well, the knowledge that they have, with, well, as Mr Cameron asked earlier about the buildings and restoring them.
Absolutely, but there's a wider point than this. Yes, it's the cultural organisations that can give particular specific advice in relation to the sort of heritage, the built heritage buildings, whether that is churches, synagogues and the like, but there's a wider point about municipal reconstruction, because we've seen the wholesale destruction of towns, where literally all that is left is, you know, the roads and the sewage system, and so there are communities right across Ukraine who are going to need expertise, and that would be something that our local authorities could perhaps play a role in. They, you know, have excellent road departments and housing departments, and maybe something for our colleagues in the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities to look at. There may be ways that we can be helping in a broader sense, and I think it would be excellent that we would aspire to that.
Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, Ms. Baker's been at another committee. I'm minded to allow questions, but if I feel they've already been answered, we're not going to repeat, and you can direct Ms. Baker to the official report. But Ms. Baker, would you like to ask your questions?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Apologies, I had to attend a corporate body. I have had a member of staff been watching the session, so hopefully I won't repeat prior questions, but apologies.
If it's a really difficult question, I'll say I've answered it already.
The first two relate to the previous panel we had this morning. So when Ian Munro was in, we did ask him about the Youth Music Initiative. Yes. He explained the situation with that, but he did say that other funding streams are being reviewed currently and discussions are ongoing. Do you know when those discussions are likely to conclude, as there will be organisations waiting to hear what happens to those funds?
So I wasn't being serious when I said I wouldn't answer difficult questions, and this is a difficult question. And the reason why it's a difficult question is it's part of the emergency budget process that we're currently in. All of our funding decisions are part of the review process. So I think the Deputy First Minister, and I don't want to misquote the Deputy First Minister, so I brought along what he had to say in terms of the timelines of things, because I think it's quite important. So he was making the point, which is understandable, that we're in a difficult circumstance because of the impact of the recent UK mini budget, and we're aware of the problems that has brought with it. But we have the added challenge that has not been informed by independent forecasts by the Office of Budget Responsibility. And that's why, I think all colleagues know this, Deputy First Minister has announced that he now has an advisory panel that is helping advise him during this emergency budget process that we are having to go through in Scotland as a result of what's gone on elsewhere. So I quote from him giving evidence to the Finance and Public Administration Committee. This is the Deputy First Minister speaking. I'm expecting to conclude the Scottish Government's emergency budget review in late October. As part of this work, I've established an expert panel of economists who will assess the impact on Scotland of the UK Chancellor's fiscal approach. Now, I imagine that Ms. Baker may already have a supplementary which may go along the lines of there are cultural organisations who wish to have best clarity about their financial situation. And that's something that I was making, a point I was making to Mr. Ruskell in general terms, because we have as a government, and I know the committee shares this as an aspiration, having a much more multi-annual approach to funding decisions and an understanding of what the financial horizon might be for all kinds of organisations. I appreciate at the present time that there are some who do not have that. So firstly, there is still the aspiration to try and give maximum understanding over more than one financial year. But point two, I recognise the fact that we're in the middle of a budget process where decisions are having to be made, and that people will want to have certainty as quickly as they can. I'm really not in a position to go further than say, I appreciate the point that's being made. I understand the question that's been made. I'm not in a position to answer in detail, save to say that is an absolute priority for me, that if there is any organisation that is needing urgent clarification, I would want to seek to be able to provide that. So if there are any specific cases that Ms. Baker has in mind that she would want my officials to be aware of, please do that. But I've pointed out the process that the Deputy First Minister is engaged in. I am very actively involved in my vocal support of protecting maximum spending capability in the culture portfolio. That also is ongoing. And so I would hope to be able to report back in person or in writing, if that were more expeditious, as soon as we're able to confirm the details of what that means in general terms, but also if there are any specific cultural organisations that are needing clarity, that they have that as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. But I hope Ms. Baker appreciates that I can't go further than that, given, and it's just the unfortunate timing of circumstances that we are trying to talk about the budgetary process while it's still ongoing in the middle of a financial crisis. So I will try and get back as quickly as I can to give the detail both to members of the committee, but but also any organisations who feel that they're in that very acute situation.
And we do have the budget statement when we return after recess, so it might be an opportunity after that for Creative Scotland to receive more clarity over which funds they can progress with and which might have to be...
I hope all organisations, whether they're agencies and then cultural organisations that flow from that, can have maximum clarity as quickly as possible for the very obvious reasons that we are talking about.
Now, we also heard from Ian Munro this morning quite a bleak picture for the cultural sector, a real risk of contraction within the sector, concerns over closures, particularly organisations that had buildings and infrastructure, compared to pandemic, where 151 million was put in and real efforts were made to support the sector through that crisis. We are now facing a second crisis that they this morning have said they feel is more significant than the crisis we thought we would, was so life-changing for everybody. We're in a more difficult situation. So just to think, I know the government is under extreme financial pressure. The budget review is about looking for savings in order to make investment in key areas that I think we share where the key areas are. But there is, a concern for these type of sectors, which have huge contributions to tourism and to our economy, that as a country we invested significant amounts of public sums in already, to the risk of them collapsing at this point after everything we've gone through. And I recognise how challenging that is for the government to resolve. But does the government recognise, is the link being made that 2 years ago we spent a lot of public money in these areas? Mm-hmm. We can't really let them fail now. And because I know the convener pressed for time, one of the things that was in the programme for government, I think last year, was the percentage of government spend from projects going into culture, and that was something that the Culture Committee in the previous Parliament did argue for. So that's maybe one proposal the government could see as a solution in this. But, is the government making the link between the public money that went in 2 years ago and what needs to happen now?
Yes, and yes. We have covered some of this ground whilst you were at the corporate body meeting. In general terms, making the point that additional funding was made available during COVID to provide funding for the Scottish Government to decide how it would dispense to deal with the COVID emergency. And very significant additional support was provided to the cultural sector for the reasons that Ms. Baker quite rightly points out. It's also important to put on record, we do not have additional funding to deal with the circumstances in which we find ourselves at the present time. So unless there is additional funding or additional powers of the Scottish Parliament to have the funding, as we know, we are pretty much unique in world governance terms and not being able to borrow in the times of an emergency. So we are having to manage our finances within the constrained devolution settlement that we find ourselves in. Would I feel bitter as an organisation supported throughout COVID to try and emerge from COVID and find myself in constrained financial circumstances with much diminished support? No doubt I would. We are doing everything that we can to try and use the resources that we have, whilst being absolutely frank, both with cultural organisations and with yourselves, about the scale of the challenge. Unless somebody is able to come along and say to me, here is additional funding as there was during COVID, there is not going to be additional funding in general. We are in an unenviable situation. And for some organisations, it is going to be extremely difficult because there is not the same scale of additional funding that there was during COVID, just at a time as we are trying to recover. So, I understand the point that Ms. Baker is trying to make very, very well. I think I would draw attention to the point that she was making, and it is one that I make regularly, which is that there is a significant part of spending in the cultural sector from the Scottish Government through Creative Scotland and Screen Scotland, for example, which is is key to unlocking additional resource in the wider economy. And I'm extremely keen to make sure that as we're having to make difficult decisions, we're not losing sight of the fact that we are talking about an important part, yes, of the nation's cultural life, but also the economy and different economic sectors. And I'm making that case very loud and clear within government. And I know people are listening to it, but as I've now made the point a number of times, colleagues are having to make very difficult decisions on the basis of constrained financial circumstances with the additional problem of inflation, which, as this committee has heard, in many parts of the creative sector is running significantly higher than the 10% in the general economy. 30% was a number that I was hearing quite a lot from certain cultural organisations.
Mm. The scale of the challenge is immense, and it's not going to be resolved by smaller projects, but the government did mention the percentage for the arts scheme and programme for government in 2021-22. Has any progress been made on taking that forward?
Ms Baker is drawing me into an exchange on the ongoing emergency budget process within the Scottish Government. Her point is being made. I hear it. And I hope she is hearing that I'm saying I am being as vocal and outspoken and constructive as she and the committee would expect me to be during an internal budget process to make sure that we have the best possible settlement in the circumstances to support the cultural sector. But unfortunately, I can't say more than that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, Ms Baird, thank you very much for your attendance at committee this morning. We do have another agenda. Oh, sorry, Mark, did you want to? It'll need to be very quick.
Okay.
You're looking when you said quick. I feel suitably guided.
I was reflecting on your points about Short Life Working Group and about the mainstreaming of cultural work across other colleagues' departments. How transparent will that be in the forthcoming budget? Will we be able to look at the health budget, look at the budget for justice, and actually see a thread of cultural and wellbeing work with numbers on it, ideally, that may or may not add up to 1%, but regardless, will actually show the impact of that work in the forthcoming year and where the spend is working across departmental way? Or are we too early for that kind of transparency within the budget?
So my answer to that will be the same as it was to Ms Baker. We're in the middle of a process. Mr Ruskell's point is very well made. I will be taking it away. I'll be discussing with officials about how we can satisfy transparency, because as I've often said to this committee before, I understand how important that is to your work and for us to be able to collegially make progress with something that is a shared endeavour. So I will take that away, and no doubt as we emerge from the budget process and there's greater certainty about things, and you will no doubt have wider questions than that point, that we're able to answer that directly. If I can leave it there.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Ms Baird. If I could ask people to clear the room quickly, as we do have another agenda item and are now very pressed for time. Thank you. I close the public meeting. Thank you.